In this video, I want to talk a little bit more about the basic accounting equation, assets equals liabilities plus stockholders' equity, and the structure of the financial statements that we were discussing earlier. I want to focus in today a little bit more on the stockholders' equity piece of the accounting equation. This piece is actually comprised of two components: common stock and retained earnings. So let's talk about each one of these. Common stock is basically represented by a stock certificate. It represents an ownership interest in the company. So what will happen is companies will sell a stock certificate to a buyer who becomes a shareholder in the company. Basically, they own a small piece of the company via this stock certificate. Companies do this as a way to raise money. And this becomes what we call contributed capital to the company. So the first component of stockholders' equity you need to understand is this component of common stock. There are, of course, different classes of stock. We'll focus mostly on common stock here. But as we move along, we may encounter some other classes of stock as well, such as preferred stock. The second piece of stockholders' equity is a little bit more difficult to understand. It's called retained earnings. I like to think of retained earnings as basically a starting and ending balance, or describing it as part of what we call a roll forward statement. So for instance, let's say we had a brand new company here that started on January 1st. The retained earnings in this company would be zero. In other words, there's been no activity in this company because it's brand new, so thus there's no carryover retained earnings in the company because they haven't earned anything. Throughout the year, though, via the closing process, what will happen is the company will add net income to retained earnings, meaning net income will transfer to retained earnings. We actually saw that back in the early chapter problems where we were looking at the impact of, say, revenue and expenses on retained earnings. So, for instance, in our example here, let's say that the income statement resulted in net income of $800 for the year, and that net income is now transferred over to the retained earnings balance and added to it. Other things that might impact retained earnings are dividends. Dividends are amounts that are paid back to the shareholders. Think of it just like a return of capital back to the shareholders. Dividends are just a return of capital. They're not an expense to the company. They're just basically returning capital that they had previously paid in. So that would actually reduce retained earnings, as we can see here on the statement, leaving an ending retained earnings at December 31st of $500. So what you're looking at here is what we call a retained earnings statement, and retained earnings is part of the total stockholders' equity balance. Our basic accounting equation still has to hold true. If you're looking at your equation here and just expanding it out for our two additional categories here, common stock and retained earnings, you can see here, you could probably guess what the question mark would be if we have assets of 1,000, liabilities of 300, and let's say your retained earnings balance was 500, your common stock would have to be 200 in order to balance this equation out. Now, we can take the retained earnings statement and the retained earnings balance and fit it into a broader stockholders' equity a statement that you can see here. A stockholders' equity statement includes both components: the common stock, as you can see here on the bottom left-hand side, and then, say, an accounting for the retained earnings, which you can see here is just a little mini statement built in here where we started with zero, we added 800 minus 300 in dividends, and you can see here that the two components, 200 plus 500 equals total stockholders' equity of $700. This up here in the upper right-hand section is just a reminder that the $800 in net income actually comes from the calculation on the income statement. The statement of changes in stockholders' equity is one of our financial statements, just like the balance sheet and just like the income statement. So the statement of changes in stockholders' equity then becomes part of our balance sheet. So you can see here our balance sheet, our assets, liabilities, and stockholders' equity. And you can see here with some sample numbers, if we had assets, equaling $1,000, then our liabilities plus stockholders' equity must also equal $1,000. You probably already noticed that there is an order to the financial statements. It must be prepared in the following order. You must prepare the income statement first, because you need the net income from that statement to prepare the statement of changes in stockholders' equity, or some people just refer to as the stockholders' equity statement. And you need the stockholders' equity total in order to prepare your balance sheet. The last statement is what we refer to as the statement of cash flows. The statement of cash flows displays inflows and outflows of cash over a period of time. This statement, believe it or not, is a little different from the income statement, because the income statement uses accrual-based accounting, where we record revenues when they're earned and expenses when they're incurred. The statement of cash flows doesn't follow those same rules. The statement of cash flows only cares about when cash is received and when cash is paid. The three major categories in the statement of cash flows are operating, investing, and financing. Operating activities are inflows and outflows from and to customers and suppliers. The operating activities section basically encompasses all of your day-to-day operations. So your dealings with customers, whether or not you invoice a customer or collect a payment from a customer, or whether you pay a vendor or a supplier, these would be what we'd call normal day-to-day operations and be included under the operating activities section. The investing activities are inflows from the sale of inflows or outflows from the sale of long-term assets. Things like buying a building or selling a piece of machinery would be included under the investing activities section. Financing activities are from borrowing activities or from things like issuing stock. So earlier we talked about issuing common stock. That would be a financing activity as we sell that stock to raise capital. It could also be a result of, say, going to a bank and getting a loan. That would be a financing activity. We typically see longer term activities under financing activities. So if you went to a bank and got, say, a long-term loan that was due 1 year or more, it would go under financing activities. Any paybacks of those loans and obligations would also go under financing activities as well.